Lord, bless you, Lord, bless you, Lord. Bless you, Lord, bless you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Have your way.
desire, Lord. You're our desire, Lord. Everything is yours. Tonight, God is here. And we've been in revival for a while, and we're known to do things a little differently. But I come tonight to love on Jesus. I wasn't here last night. I had a little accident. I fell down. Cracked a rib, maybe. I actually pulled cartilage away from it. And I'm not singing much because I can't hardly breathe. But I still want to love Jesus. And tonight, Steve, I want to say something just real straight. I want us to get out of the religion and really worship Jesus. You see, worship is not contingent on whether I can sing or Mike can sing. It's all about the condition of the heart.
Yes, that's right.
And I was driving here, my wife was driving here, I was riding with her, and I was anticipating, and I said, Lord, thank you for all that you've done, and I enter your gates with thanksgiving, and I thank you for all you've done, but Lord, I want somehow to pour more out to you in the way of worship. And as we started to sing this song, Pastor, I'm just going to take my liberty, it's all right, I have a dear friend here. Singers can just stay where you are, choir, stay where you are. We're not done. I have a new friend that's dear to me that's here. Her name is Rita Springer. And Rita's got a wonderful song about being broken and poured out before the Lord. And I'm putting her on the spot. But Rita, I just want Rita to come. And Mike, stay close. Everybody stay close because we don't know what we're going to do. We'll sing some more choir songs. But I just feel the Spirit of the Lord here. And I want to really worship Him. I want to see His eyes. I want to see His face. And Rita knows how to take us there. Rita. You obey the Lord, honey.
Well, I'm not as freaked out as I was last time He did this to me. I got on a plane last Sunday with what I thought was Jesus to go to this women fest this week, and was completely touched and blown away by God, and I realized that I think I got on that plane with maybe Jesus' hands and part of His feet and maybe a small portion of His heart, but I'm going to go home tomorrow with a little more of the whole thing. This song basically just comes out of Mark 14, which is where the Lord ruined me and where I doubt I'll ever be the same. And I think it's the purest and the most vulnerablest form of worship that there is. And it's when a woman comes before Jesus and she dumps everything she has over Him. And in my own relationship with the Lord, I just felt like the Lord told me that whatever is in that vial of perfume, whether it be our shame, our sin, our pain, that the Lord wants it dumped out over Him. And so I just ask that we do that right now. Thank you. ourselves over
just and worthiness. could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your deep love forever, love. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love. Oh, the mountains and the sea, your river runs, it loves me. And I love them, my heart, and then the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth.
See the Lord and lift him up. Will anyone see the Lord and lift him up? See only Jesus. 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 Oh, Lamb of God. Lamb of God, Lamb of God, Lamb of God. Oh, yeah. Yeah. No.
men of faith, rise up and sing of the great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak, in your brokenness complete. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven. Rise up, women of the truth, stand and sing to broken hearts.
Come on, Mike.
Who can know the healing power of our awesome King of love? Come on, shout,
shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus, the Savior to all, Lord of heaven.
See it, go.
Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus, the Savior to all, Lord of heaven.
Fire, we've been through rain, we've been refined by the power of His name. We've fallen deeper in love with You. You burn the truth on our lips.
Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus, the Savior. Savior to all, Lord of heaven.
Come on, sing.
Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven.
You are Lord.
You are Lord of heaven and earth. You are Lord. You are Lord of heaven.
yes, Lord, we praise you. Whew. Hallelujah. 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 Next.
Yeah.
your river flow, Lord. Come on, Jesus. Let your river flow over us, Lord. Flow over us, Lord. Flow over us, Lord.
Flow over us, Lord.
Flow over us, Lord.
Flow over us, Lord.
Flow over us, Lord. River flow. Fire burn.
Fire burn.
Let your river flow, Jesus. One more time.
River flow. Oh, fire burn. Fire.
This is fun because I'm used to just taking off and now I'm having to. We can just do anything, can't we, huh? God, good. There it is. Can you make that guitar up? One, two, three, and.
Every breath I take, I breathe in you. Waves of mercy, waves of mercy, waves of grace. Everywhere I look, I see your face. Your love has captured me. Oh my God, this love, how can it be? Taking you, you are my way, Jesus. Every breath I take, I breathe in you.
know, we often get caught up in the things that God does, and what he does is wonderful. And throughout the Psalms, the psalmist rehearses the acts of God and what he's done through the years. And in the Gospels, we have what Jesus has done, and the book of Acts, what the Holy Spirit did through the apostles. But more than beholding the acts of God and the wonders of God is the glory of gazing on God himself. The great reward of heaven is not the streets of gold. It's not the tree of life. It's not even the amazing creation that we'll see. It's not even fellowshipping one with another forever and ever. It's not even no more sickness or pain or sorrow. The great reward of heaven is that the word says that we will see the face of God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And every night, there's a different flavor in the revival. We may start every night with songs and worship and then see which way it goes from there. Some nights, the whole place is exploding and shouting and jumping and dancing all over the place. And that may happen yet momentarily or before the night's out. And other nights, we're just on our faces and weeping. And some nights, there's just a quieter spirit and we're just worshiping and gazing on the Lord. And I believe many really started to take hold of that as we sang, I can sing of the Lord's love forever. And that's really what it's all about, friends. Not did you get the new job, not were you healed in your body. And those things are important. You may have needs. You may be sick in body. Not did people like your message, not did your family do well, did your kids do well in school. The real thing is, are you experiencing the love of the Lord? Are you loving him? Are you walking in his grace? Is there harmony? Is there fellowship? Jesus said to his Father shortly before his death on the cross, he said, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you've sent. That's the whole essence of life, knowing God. And in a service like tonight, we're up to now, it's just been a little quieter, the same spirit, same working of God, just a little quieter. It helps us to step back and just gaze on the Lord and just tell him we love him. Just let's do this one last time before you sit down. Just close your eyes, raise your hands to God, and just in your own words, tell him how much you love him. Just in your own words, just tell him you love him. Tell him he means more to you than anything in this world. Jesus, I love you so much, Lord. Jesus, I love you. I love you. God, I can never express to you how much I love you. Lord, you're more wonderful than I could ever imagine. You've been better to me than I could ever imagine, God. Lord, nothing in me whatsoever deserves your goodness, your love. I love you, Lord. I love you, God. Oh, God, help us to be grateful. Help us to be thankful. Help us to be heavenly minded. Thank you, God, for sparing us from judgment and hell, saving us from our sins, delivering us from the folly of the flesh and the slavery of Satan. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We love you. We love you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You can be seated. For Malta, he's out witnessing tonight. Couldn't miss two straight nights of witnessing. Otherwise, here are the four. Nate and Sarah and Fabian were in the back seat, and Ellie and Gay were in the front seat. And they were wearing seat belts. Those of you who are very spiritual, you still need to wear seat belts. You say, well, I have faith. Well, according to your faith, don't break the law, because it's law here in Florida also. So that's settle that. But I got back into the hospital, and Ellie and Gay were laid out. They had neck braces. They didn't want them moving around or anything. And what happened to Ellie, it was kind of a miracle. Her head was actually severed, and they put it back on and just put this little brace on for a couple days. So I come back there, and they're beaming. They're all smiles. Just all smiles. I mean, you saw them. They're just laying there smiling. You know, Gay, she was in some pain, didn't know. She'd broken some things. In fact, they were taking x-rays of her neck. And they said, we got to take a few more. We only found five bones, and there's seven, so we didn't get it all. So I just said, check again, because we only allow students in if they have all seven bones in their neck. So we wanted to be sure. But, you know, they're shaking up. It's a bad accident. You know, real ugly mess there. You know, it was quite a scene. But Ellie was beaming, and there was one thing that she said. I'm sure you remember it, what your hope and your prayer was. I just want you to see the quality of these young people that, God sent to us. But just tell everybody what your real prayer was after you realized your car was totaled and so on. And let everybody know.
My car is just covered in, basically repent. You know, Jesus loves you. And I know that God has divine appointments, and I know that there's only one car that I've ever seen like mine, and it's going to go to one junkyard, and one junk man is going to see it, and that guy is going to get saved in the name of Jesus.
And some of them are in the hospital thinking, well, you know what? Why God sent me to the hospital? Who am I supposed to witness to? And now the car is going to be told and go to the junkyard. So their heart, their attitude is, maybe the junkyard man's going to get saved. That's going to be a witness. See, that's how they live. That's how they breathe. And they're not just going to do it while they're in school here. When they go out of school, they're going to live the same way. And anybody else have anything you just may want to share? You were in a bad wreck and could have been fatal, could have been seriously injured. Anything?
Just give me a chance to witness to people. And they didn't argue. They just like they received it, and I hope they planted a seed, and so I hope I'll see them in heaven.
Now think here. You're a single person. You're here alone in Florida, just brand new in the school here. She was bleeding, got her finger stitched up. They didn't know if their ribs busted or anything. And what she's thinking, man, I got to witness to people in the hospital. I got to share the gospel. So some of you may have heard there was an accident, and there were a whole bunch of students surrounding the area there that just happened to be there when the thing happened. And I want you to know that God is good. Are you guys going to, like, witness less now after the accident? Or are you guys going to, like, withdraw or step back? Or you ever been in a bad accident before?
No. That was my first accident.
Maybe the last.
Hopefully.
Yes. What about your heart for souls, and what's going on in you?
I was happy last night because when I was in the hospital, there was a guy sitting in the emergency room, and Dr. Brown kind of leaned over to me and said, "Why don't you go pray for him?"
Well, hang on. This guy he looked like he could have been a biker. Yeah. He was heavy set, and he had a ponytail, I think a few tattoos, and had the worst hacking cough I've ever heard. I mean, there's this, and it was, first it bothered you hearing it, then your heart's going out. You think any second his insides, you know, his heart's going to come out of his mouth. There's, you know, constant retching. And he's in the emergency room, so you know it's fairly serious, you know. So I thought, well, you know, he wouldn't be threatened by Nate going over there to him. And here, you know, Nate's just gotten checked out. He was shaken up. You know, been a bad wreck, you're a little shaken up. You know, they didn't know if he'd broken anything or anything like that. And so Nate just went over.
I walked over to him and I said, do you mind if I pray for you? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, do you go to church anywhere? And he said, well, I haven't been to church since I was a teenager. And I said, well, Jesus loves you, and I want to pray for you if you'll let me. And so he let me pray for him, and I had some couple tracks in my shirt pocket, and I handed him one, and I prayed for him. So I just got a chance to witness him a little bit. But
and when he said he prayed, I mean, he laid hands on him, he poured his heart out and prayed for him. And listen, I just want you to understand something. These are regular people, you know. When I just put my arm around Ellie there before, you know, I don't know if she hurt. She said, oh, because last night nothing seemed to hurt her at all. I put my arm around her tonight. She was in a bit of an accident. These are regular people. You know, Sarah's first time out witnessing with the team there, and she ends up in an accident actually, she didn't fracture. She didn't do anything, but we wanted her to get a little attention, so we put that thing on her there. But, you know, listen, this is how you have to live your whole life. This is how you have to. Now, here's what I want you to understand. Ellie and Gay were still in the hospital. They had to stay for x-rays, but everybody else came back to the school. We figured they'd just been in a wreck, just go back to your room, just rest, just do something. No, we went back to the school. Why? Because we were having a midnight to 5 prayer meeting last night, praying for this gospel to go out from the school of ministry to the ends of the earth. How long did you stay there last night, Sarah?
Till 5.
Till 5 in the morning. So after her first wreck with a minor fracture and all that, shaken up like you would be, she goes to the school and prays till 5 in the morning for the gospel to go out to the nation. So this is what we're all about, friends. You want to say something?
That's my writing hand. It's my left hand, so I can still do homework at the School of Ministry.
Yeah, well, that's a requirement. If any students are in an accident, that they cannot injure their writing hand, because we don't take excuses easily. So God bless you. I just want to give the good report. Thanks. Bless you.
Tonight, we want to welcome everybody here from wherever you're from. How many of you are from outside the state of Florida? Could I see your hand, please? Outside the state of Florida. How many of you? Let's see. How many of you from outside the United States? Could I see your hand, please? Outside the United States. Just, I'll tell you what. Everybody else be seated for a moment except those from outside America. Just remain standing for just a moment. We're going to find out real quickly, just get a snippet of where these people are from. Let's start back there in the back. Where are you from? South Africa. All right. I'll tell you what. Everybody just hold your applause till we get through, because it's going to take too long. Yeah. Australia? New Zealand? Korea? All right, Korea? Germany? Colombia? Germany? All you guys from Germany? Australia? Say that.
Australia?
Yeah. Where are you from? Germany? Jamaica? Holland? England? Germany? England. All right. Yes, ma'am. England? Germany? England? Malaysia, wow. Canada? Malta, gee whiz. Hi. Northern Territory of Australia, all right. England? Canada? Did you have a Charlie horse over there, son? Where are you from? Australia. Switzerland, England, Brazil. What about up in the balcony? Yeah. Australia. All right, Canada. Holland. Bulgaria. Wow. Germany. Switzerland. Australia. Japan, all right. Let's give all of our international guests a big hand. Robert. Come here, Robert. I hear that your brother got saved the other night. Man, what about that? Come on over. What's your brother's name?
Richard.
Richard. He got saved.
Yes.
Richard Robert.
Richard Lowell.
Richard Rowe. But Richard Robert.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir. It's a big thing. It's a big
How big thing. Is it?
He's a big young man.
He's here. Well, how long have you been praying for him?
Since I got saved.
Did you think you'd ever get saved?
No, sir.
Let's go back here, you and your brother together. You act like Robert. You act like you're sort of traumatized. You're in shock.
Yes, sir, I am. Just a lot of things that I know that are going to happen now in our family as a whole, because see, we have two brothers. I have two brothers and two sisters, so now.
Okay, you got Richard in.
Yes.
You want to stand up here with Richard? You got Richard in. What about the other two now?
Well, we have an older brother, and he's
What's
in
his name?
Harold. And Harold is in Atlanta, and then we have a sister, Mary, and a sister, Jackie. And they're all three older than us.
Harold, Mary, and Jackie.
Harold, Mary, and Jackie.
You know what I got a feeling?
I got it. Yes, sir.
They hadn't got a chance.
I think you.
You see, if your faith brought him in, think what can happen if both of your faiths are joined together.
That's right. One day at a time.
Yeah.
One day.
Harold, how old is he? Is he the oldest?
Yes, sir. He's 50-ish. How old is he, Rick?
You're in your 30s, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
No, sir.
How old are you?
I'm 48.
You're 48?
Yes, sir.
You don't look it.
Thank you.
You look 60.
No.
I'm kidding you, man. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. But Harold's in his 50s.
Yes, sir.
And this is Richard, and he's just here. Yes, yeah. Here. We won't get into that. Richard, what in the world's going on? What do you think about this stuff?
Well, it took me a couple of years to, now I have to back up. It took me, took me almost 3 years to make it over here.
Where do you live?
That's 90 miles, 150, Panama City.
Panama City?
Mm-hmm. How far it is?
It took you 3 years to get here.
Well, it took me 3 years to, yes, sir, to get here.
So, whenever you heard about your brother and sister-in-law getting over here and this stuff, did you hear about the revival over there before they got here?
I heard about it shortly before, and
what did you think about what you heard?
I really didn't believe it.
Yeah.
I had to. I was hypocritical, and I made the statement to my family, "You'll never catch me in Brownsville." Yeah. That was.
What do you think would have happened if this thing would have shut down 6 months ago?
Well, I really feel in my heart that I would have made it somewhere. I'm a sinner, and
but you would have missed a revival.
I would have missed a revival, and I really would have missed something. I made the statement, and I have to say this to everybody. Again, I was a hypocrite, and you know, do not everybody that I got close to. You know, you got to watch out for Brownsville. You go over there and something happens to you, but I didn't mean it in a good way.
Yeah.
But
how'd you mean it?
I meant it, I didn't know about it. I just didn't know what the movement.
Strange stuff happened?
Yeah, it was strange, and I'll tell you.
Did you think your brother turned strange after he came?
Yeah, I thought he did.
Yeah, he did.
He did. He really did.
He became strange to us, too.
Yeah. But it's honestly, you know, watch out. If you got something bad to say about Brownsville, don't sit around me.
Well, after you came.
It took me coming to get here to see, and I am a believer.
I don't want to go home.
Problem is, I don't want to go home. I called my family back in Panama City, and I was supposed to be home today. And I said, well, I'm coming home tomorrow. And then I said, well, I don't know if I'll be home tomorrow, and but I got to get back.
But now, after you heard all this stuff about the revival and about the church and everything, you had all this, you know, stuff in your mind about what you'd heard. When you actually got here, and you saw and experienced what was happening, what was your thought?
Honest to God?
Yeah.
Why didn't I come 3 years ago? I mean, that's it. And that's all I can say.
Yeah. And now that you're here, you don't want to leave?
I know that I've got to leave. There's still a lot going on in my life, and it's going to, you know, it's going to take time to get everything worked out. But at least I read several years ago, you can go down that wrong road, but you know in your heart, you know, not you, not anyone here knows how I feel. Only the men upstairs know how I feel in my heart. And that's all I have to answer to. Jesus has been good to me just a couple of years ago. Unfortunately, it didn't just take coming to Brownsville. It opened my eyes coming to Brownsville. I like I said, just going down that wrong road, I found that exit to get off of, and you know, wasn't able to make it all the way back before I'd go down the road again. But you know, I'm.
You know, the good thing about that is though, you got somebody now that'll walk that road with you.
Yes, I do.
Yeah, he'll go with you.
People, I've got a lot of people that'll walk that road.
He'll go with you, and he'll help you. And I tell you what, don't ever try to project how things are going to be, because with the Lord on your side, they're not going to be quite like that anymore. Before, you was fighting the battle by yourself. Now God's going to help you fight your battle.
Praise Jesus.
God bless you, man. Good to have you. All right. Good man. You know what we need to do? We need to stand up and pray for the rest of his family. That's what we need to do. Come on up here, Robert. You and Richard. For some reason, I want to call you Richard Roberts. I don't know. Somebody, come on up. But I want us to pray and ask God to save Harold. And what's your sister's name?
Harold, Rick, Harold, Jackie, and Mary.
Jackie and Mary. I want you to extend your hand this way. The Lord knows where his sisters and his brother is. He knows. And Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that these sisters and this brother will not be able to escape the net of the Holy Ghost. Father, bring them in. And even as we stand here tonight, Lord, let even the word that reaches their ear about Richard being saved, after he's joined Robert now and God's done a great work in their life, let the very word that reaches their ear, let it excite their soul. Let conviction begin to fall already. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. God bless you.
Lord, to tell of all you've done, of how you've changed my life and wiped away the past. I want to shout it out from every rooftop seat, for now I know that God is for me, not against me.
I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul. Bursting, Lord, to tell of all you've done, of how you've changed my life and wiped away the past. I want to shout it out from every rooftop seat, for now I know that God is for me, not against me.
I could sing unending songs of how you saved my soul.
Could see your face, see you smiling over us, unseen angels celebrate, 'cause the joy is in this place.
Come on, sing. How many are going to let the Lord speak to them tonight? Amen. Me too. I want everyone to pray the prayer we've been praying since Father's Day. I found something, Mike, today. We're working on a Bible with Thomas Nelson. There is a need, we feel, that Thomas Nelson Publishing, you've heard of, they're the largest and oldest Bible publishing company in the world, been around for 200 years. And they approached us and asked us if we would be willing to work on a Bible that has to do with revival. Now, the whole Bible is revival, but in it, to share some of the principles of revival, bring out the scriptures where revival fell, the characteristics, where it fell, why it fell, who was involved, why they were involved, what happened before, what happened after. Just as you're reading through the Word, the revival from Genesis to Revelation. And how many feel like that'd be a good? We do too. And we've got, there's about 40 of us working on it. And of course, God wrote most of it. And so anyway, it's going to be an awesome work, and it's going to come out this year. And we're not sure what it's going to be titled, but you'll be seeing it from Thomas Nelson. And it's going to have a lot of, you know, we'll talk about Finney's hindrances to revival. And people, as we travel around in Awake Americas, people just eat that up. They want to hear the 18 points or the 16 points. And stuff like that's going to be in there. Mike's going to have a lot of his teaching in there. David Ravenhill, Bob Phillips, Pastor Kilpatrick, and several leaders that you'll recognize from around the world are going to be a part of it. Anyway, I was working on it this morning. And as I was working on it, I came across a letter that somehow did not get tossed. And it's a letter from you back in August of 1996, two and a half years ago. It was so cool reading this. He says, "Dear Steve," "I was just checking my journal notes and I discovered that it was 2:47 a.m. this past Father's Day," this is Father's Day of June of 96, "that the Lord began," 1 year, the revival was 1 year old, "that the Lord began to speak to me about helping to raise up a serious equipping school in Brownsville." And he said, "Do you think the timing is significant? We need to talk more when I come down next week." Isn't that cool? And, you know, this is pre-revival school of ministry. And, and we were all bouncing the idea around, you know, well, what do you, you know, because a lot of folks, people would come to the revival and just hang out. And we'd say, "Where are you from?" They said, "Pennsylvania." And we'd say, "Well, what do you do?" They say, "Well, I hang out here. I live here." And I said, "Well, what do you do? I just live here." "And what are you doing?" "Well, I come to the revival, go to the Bible classes, go to Mike's classes." And they were putting themselves through Bible school by coming to the revival. And so it started making sense. It's almost like everything that's happened right around here we've stumbled into. But this is an awesome letter, brother. How God was speaking to you back then, and I'm so glad he was. How many are thankful for the school of ministry? We're going to ask the Lord to speak to our hearts, change our lives, and I'm going to let you be seated for a few minutes. I want you to pray this seriously tonight. I know God's going to speak to you. Those of you at home, I want you to pray this seriously. I know God will speak if you'll listen and if you'll pray seriously. We're going to ask the Lord to speak to our hearts and to change our lives. Everyone pray together right now. Dear Jesus, speak to my heart. Change my life. In your precious name, amen. You may be seated. Richard, I'm proud of you, man. Let me tell you something. He which hath begun a good work in you, the Bible says, Philippians 1:6, you can read this in the New Testament. He which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. God is not like men or women who start something and never finish it. God always completes his projects. You look at creation. He finished it. And what he starts in you, he'll finish it. And so you don't need to be preoccupied on the hows and the whens and what's going to happen. If you live every day, and I speak to everybody here, the Bible says When they asked Jesus how to pray, he said this: when you pray, pray like this: Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this week give us this day our daily bread. There's a principle here that a lot of us miss. We want bread for June of 99. We want a word for June of 99. The Bible says, give us this day our daily bread. That's all we need is food, spiritual, physical food for today. And if you live like that, and don't be concerned about March of 99 or April of 99 or the year 2000 or Y2K, just live today. God will take care of your tomorrows. I'm speaking some wisdom to you, friend. I have learned this. Many of you that are so hyped out over Y2K, I want to tell you what's going to happen to you. You're going to be so inundated. It's like this huge balloon in front of you. And by the time, this is what I feel. This is not prophetic. This is just how I feel. By the time the year 2000 comes around, that big old monster is going to be deflated. And you see it happening every single week. Major corporations are putting out in Newsweek, Time Magazine, how they got it licked. They got it licked. One of the first ones to have it licked was the Social Security Administration. Major government organizations. They said, hey, we did it. It's over. Year 2000 comes around, your check will be in the mail. Don't worry about it. Give us this day. I would not worry about Y2K. I'd worry about today. Take time for today. Amen. Somebody needed to hear that. I think hundreds needed to hear that. Now, if you disagree with me about Y2K, that's okay, because it's not in the Bible, okay? And you can, you know, you can have your opinion on it. I've got mine. But what bothers me is so many people spend so much time on stuff, and they'll spend a whole year analyzing this thing, dissecting it, while their neighbor goes to hell. Their neighbor will be in a car accident, June of 99, being in critical condition at the hospital, but this Christian is so concerned about reading the latest literature on what's going to happen at the end of the century that their neighbor dies and goes to hell in the hospital. That's the kind of stuff I get tired of, friend. Last night, while preparing to leave for revival, the Lord began speaking to me about tonight's message, which was very unusual. My mind for the last several days had been fed up, say fed up, with the condition of the world. I am tired of the corruption. I'm tired of our scandal-ridden political system. I've become less tolerant. I want you to hear me. I've become less tolerant towards those who live for God one minute and backslide the next. I'm tired of it. I'm just tired of it. Bible school student, if that's you, I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. If you're going to be a soldier, be a soldier. If not, go. Go. Just go. Go do what you want to do. I've so many people. I used to work in Teen Challenge, and when I'd watch students not give themselves to Teen Challenge, I would and give themselves to the ministry and give themselves to God, I would say, Billy, pack your bags. And he'd cry. Why? Because he's going to miss out three hots and a cot. I was feeding the kid, and I was bedding him down. I mean, he had a cozy place to live. And I'd say, get in that car. And he'd be going, get in. He'd get in the car, and I'd shut the door, and I'd drive to the interstate. And I'd say, there's the exit. Get out. I don't want to see your face again. I can't believe you're even a Christian. You're doing this. I'm sick of it, Billy. We've had you for 6 months. You've already brought down three other men in the program that were on fire for God, and you brought them down. You've slipped off the property twice already. I've already shown mercy, 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 Billy. You don't want to be here. And your tears right now won't change this decision. get out of here. Get out of my sight. Can you do that with peace in your heart? Absolutely. No problem. Any of you that are in the military, you know when it comes to physical action, I'm talking about the training's over. The war games are over. Now you're on the battlefield. The commanding officer is not going to put up with some slouch, some soldier that's spinning his rifle on his finger that could care less about going forward. You say, go forward, he turns around, sits under a tree, and smokes a cigarette. Friend, I don't think so. He'd be on the first flight home, and the general would not be going, oh man, I feel so bad about this. He'd get him out of the midst. Why? That man is going to hurt people. I'm getting this out of my system, friend, because... And it's God. I know it's God. One minute you're living for God, the next minute you're backsliding. Whew. Almost every week I hear of someone or some ministry that has been shaken by adultery, the love of money, false teaching, watered down doctrine. There seems to be a continuous real life drama of false Christs, mimickers of the Messiah, who rise up proclaiming to be somebody, and they spill out their self-concocted poison on innocent or ignorant people. Some of you, within the sound of my voice, you have been drinking the poison of devils, luring them into a lifestyle of bondage, dictatorship, all fueled by a constant flow of prophetic promises. I want everyone to look this way. If somebody comes up to you and says, Jesus is over there, he's going to be on that mountain in 3 months. Sell all you have and give to me. Friend, I don't care if that person has the power to pull up an oak tree with their pinky. It doesn't matter what kind of manifestations are swirling around that person. Run for your life. Get away from them. And many of you heard the story. You remember Jim Jones and the massacre down there. I've studied that and studied that and studied. I'm still studying it. I am still studying the Jonestown massacre because it's just so impossible for me to believe. A friend of mine had one of his friends die in the Jonestown massacre. And I look at that. And we've traced some of the things that took place in some of his meetings. And they found in some of his meetings raw liver, chicken livers, that were pulled out of people, and he said it was cancer. And the things that people will fall for. And the devil's up to everything, friend. He's up to everything. See, remind you that I've worked around the world, and I can take you to places where they can make tables levitate. I can take you to places where you will see signs and wonders that'll blow your mind. All satanic. But there are Christians, if they came into a meeting in a church house and they saw the pulpit go, they go, oh my Lord, he's here. Next news you know, you'll be in some cultic teaching. Drawn away, why? Because something tickled your ears. Something made your eyelids flutter. The Bible says, by the way, these prophetic promises, they never come true in these cults. The Bible says, hope deferred in Proverbs 13:12. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. You watch as these people's lives are shipwrecked. When their plans and their dreams are tried by the tempest of time and they're slammed up against the rocks of reality, they die spiritually and are often so delusioned that it would take a direct, incredible miracle of God to bring them back to their senses. And I'm tired. I'm telling you, I'm tired of cults and I'm tired of their demonic delusions. Part of me is saddened while another part is furious at the way once godly men and women have allowed the doctrine of Christ, the blood of the cross, the sufferings of Christ, the teachings of the Bible, the signs and wonders in the Word to become just myths and legends. Pastor knows it. We're in agreement with this. The moment anything weird enters the Brownsville revival, tries to get in, we are in total communion, all of us here. Whoever's involved in that, whoever is doing that, will be ousted, completely severed from the body. And we've had it happen, friend. Weird things try to slip in here. I'm scared, man. I'm scared. People wander. They wander away from the true way. And they turn headlong into Satan's deceptive detour, only to drive themselves and their followers and their families over the edge into a Christless eternity. I wrote this morning, friend. I'm reading it to you. I was tired when I wrote it, but God was speaking to me. I'm warning some of you. The letter such as this one that I read the other day of a major denomination sent this letter to every church in its constituency, and the letter says, we will no longer tolerate any other denomination that won't allow homosexuals, lesbians to teach in their churches. We open the doors wide. Come in. Be with us. Jesus is love. See, it sounds good when you say Jesus is love. Jesus loves everybody. Yeah, he does. Jesus didn't put up with sin, friend. Sodomy, lesbianism, homosexuality is sin, period. It is sin, and there's no place for it in the body of Christ. But this is the beginning. This is the beginning of evils. You ain't seen nothing yet. Satan's got a church out there. He's got a church, and he's going to raise it up, and he's going to suck believers in, and it's going to sound logical. I shared last night about a group of believers now that are spreading all over this nation, rumors and letters and writings on it has to do with acceptance of all world religions. And it's so logical. They say things like this: millions of millions and millions and millions of people believe this. And what they believe about God is this, and they'll pull something in that's so close to Jesus that folks will go, you know, they're not that wrong or that different. And next news you know, they're meeting in a fellowship, and you'll have Muslims, Buddhists, evangelicals all mixed together. Friend, I'm warning you. I'm warning you. I've had to look straight into the face of my own family members when it came to this. One of my family members said this to me, Steve, how can you be so adamant against some of the groups like the Mormons and Jehovah's Witness? And I said, listen to me and listen good. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man goes to the Father but through me. There is no other way in. Period. You can't work your way to heaven. There's no other book outside of the Word of the Living God. This is the only book. This is all we have and all we need. Stuff like this makes me nauseous. Yet other people that are on the edge or living in some type of lukewarm environment, they'll take this and they'll read it and they'll go, you know, maybe I need to change my harsh attitude towards that. You know, if all these people are changing, if the head of the denomination is changing their attitude, maybe I need to soften my outlook on it. After all, this is a different day we live in. Friend, this ain't a different day. A day is as a thousand years is. This is just a to God. This ain't some different day. God's God, the Word's the Word, sin is sin. And tonight, this is what we're going to talk about. We're living in a day today that has happened before. While kneeling by my bedside last night, I felt in my spirit that not only am I tired, but God is tired too. I really feel that, friend. God is not one to lay back and allow sin to reign supreme. If you don't believe that, read the word. God is a mover and a shaker. At home, you've turned on to the right broadcast, you've tuned into the right website, stay there. God is a mover. He's a shaker. When he begins to move from mercy to judgment, everything changes. And I got a feeling we are right there where God is turning from mercy and he's beginning to lash out a little bit with his judgment. And friend, one drop of God's judgment is enough to make any man live in terror. Of course, like any student of the word, when I think of God's judgment of the world, my mind immediately races to the previous judgments in the Bible. He has judged this planet before. I said he has judged this planet before. I was in a shop the other day out in Colorado, in a rock shop, a fossil shop, and they had all the fossils on display, phenomenal fossils. Every one of them were found at the same place all over the globe, the same depth under the earth. It's amazing. And they had huge chunks of fish on top of fish, on top of bird, on top of fish. Layers of dead animals. Interesting. And I walked through there with my son and I went, the flood. The flood. The flood. The flood. The flood. I'm not an archaeologist, but I know some archaeologists. And they will tell you something happened years ago that destroyed a lot of animal life. When I study his judgments, I always look for the remnant that God had. He's always got a remnant. Those who escape because of their faithfulness to him and their hatred of the sinful state of man. Well, tonight, we're going to take a look at one of my personal heroes. And probably maybe three times in this revival I've talked about this man, but not the way I'm going to talk tonight. I want to be like him. It's all fixing to come down. It's coming down. I want to be like this person. His name is Noah. And this message is entitled, A Noah Wannabe. Wanna, W-A-N-N-A-B-E. A Noah wannabe. You can put for the scripture Genesis 6:9. We'll turn there in a second. A Noah wannabe. I want to be like him. Because I am so frustrated, friend. I'm so frustrated. Pastor, I'm sick of everything. I'm sick of everything. Now, I'm the happiest man on the globe. But I'm saying to God right now, if you don't send revival, see, this is awesome what's happening here. But see, I know the difference between this and what could happen. That's what bothers me. I'm a student of revivals, and I compare this revival to other revivals, and we have some of what happened. But I know God tonight at 11:32 could come down in power, and the whole city of Pensacola could start weeping. The whole city where you live, Richard. At 12:45 in the morning, tomorrow morning, 12:45, the Spirit of the Lord, I lived in Panama City. I used to work at First Assembly of God on East Avenue. The Spirit of God could fall in Panama City, and people that are driving down the road could begin swerving and then pull their car over, jump out of their car, and fall on their face in the highway and begin weeping and wailing over their lost condition. That could happen just like that. Just like that. We're not there yet. And I'm going, Jesus, what is it going to take for you to come down in power? What is it going to take, Jesus, for your Holy Spirit to come down and melt our families and melt our schools and melt our government leaders? What is it going to take in this nation for heaven to come down? But the more I go on and the more we pray and the darker it gets, I'm wondering, maybe, Jesus, it's just plain old almost over. Now, Noah, the word Noah means rest. You need to write that down, students. It means quiet, means comfort, any kind of word like means rest. And I've made an acrostic of Noah's name, N-O-A-H. Got one word for each letter. Note takers, this will be easy. And then we're going to close tonight. And these are characteristics of this man of God that you need to have in your life. Sinner, if you're here tonight listening at home, I don't know who your hero is. I don't know if it's some basketball star, some rock star. But if you got your eyes on mortal man, you're going to miss it. You need to focus on godly characters in the Bible, on Jesus Christ. You need to focus on people that made it to heaven. You need to focus on people that made it with God. You know what I do with books in my library of people that didn't make it? I've got books in my library of people that made it all the way to their 72nd year. Then they backslid. I take books like that and trash them. I took one, Mike, and ripped it to shreds. To shreds. You want to know what? It's a great book. Makes me want to throw it on the ground and spit on it and say, don't tell me how to live for God. Don't tell me how to study the Word. Don't tell me how to pray. Don't tell me how to evangelize while you're in sin. Show me. Live for God through your youth, through your 20s, your 30s, your 40s, your 50s. And when you get your hormones going in your 50s and your wife doesn't satisfy you anymore, live for God in your 50s. Go on, fall in love all over again with your wife. Take her out on dates. Take her out on a honeymoon. Take her out on a cruise, whatever it takes, friend. And then live for God in your 60s. Live for God in your 70s. Live for God in your 80s and die a Christian man. I say that to your wives, say that to your husbands, because husbands are the biggest wimps. Man, I want to tell you something. I have counseled so many men that come up to me in their 50s, and they say things like this. You're not going to believe how this girl makes me feel. You know, they're married, they have 3 kids, and they're dating some girl that's half their age. Now, the example we have up in Washington right now. That kind of thing. And that their excuse is, she makes me feel young again. And I look at him and go, that has nothing to do with it. That has nothing to do with anything. You are a father. You're supposed to be raising your children. You said to your wife that you were going to stay with her all the days of your life till death do you part. Where is that covenant? Don't tell me that she makes you feel young again. Big deal. It's garbage, friend. It's garbage. Stand up, be a man, go after God. Quit acting like some dog out there. Is that plain? Jesus, help me. Just want to get it across. Number one, Noah was a man who lived near to God. Noah, N, near. That's your first word. Say near. Near. Noah was a man who lived near to God. The Bible says, these are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man. This is Genesis 6:9. And perfect in his generation. And Noah walked with God. Noah walked with God. Say it with me. Noah walked with God. Friend, everyone look this way. This is the highest compliment anyone can pay you, and it's certainly the highest compliment God can pay you, that you walk with him, that you talk with him, that you're a man and a woman of God. What a heritage. What a legacy. Man, to have those 4 words on my tombstone. Have those 4 words echoed from heaven right now from the Father, for him to turn to the angels and say, Steve walks with me. And Noah walked with God literally means to live, and you need to write this down, friend. It means to live in habitual fellowship. You don't live for God Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, then Monday you have an off day, so you just blow it a little bit. You backslide a little bit. Habitual fellowship. That means, friend, when you watch a movie, God watches the movie. That means when you go somewhere, God goes somewhere. No matter where you go, He goes. Why? Because you walk with God. You are near to God. You live in fellowship with God. Are you paying attention, friend? If you want to be somebody, be like Noah. Noah walked with God. I won't go anywhere where Jesus can't go. For those of you in this room are wondering, what does that mean? You know good and well what that means. Would Jesus walk into a porno shop? Nope. Would Jesus go into a strip club? Nope. We were talking a few minutes ago in the back about some of our work around the world, and we were talking about Spain, and I used to live in Spain, and we're planting churches there, and I used to take my family, we'd go down, we'd try to find a secluded beach on the Caribbean, and on the Mediterranean, and those of you that have lived in Europe, you know the nudity in Europe is just insane. I mean, young people just walk around with their clothes off. And I remember going to the beach with my son. And we were all alone. And then this huge bus pulled up of teenagers, like a youth group, okay? Pulled up from Germany. Forgive me, Germans, but this is exactly what happened. And they all got out. And they were all clothed. They had shirts on and clothes on, and they all walked to the beach and sat down. I thought, this is safe. They're going to play some ball, you know, some volleyball, whatever. Then they started taking their clothes off. All of them. Just, I went, Ryan, it's time to go. He goes, but why, Daddy? He said, this is a good spot. I said, this was a good spot, son. Why? I won't hang around where Jesus won't hang around. Now, some of you here are so spiritual, you'd go, oh, you know, I guess God wants me to evangelize here. I want all the guys to look at me. No, he doesn't. No, he doesn't. Oh, there's a work to do here, Jesus. Look at this mess, Jesus. I just, send me, I'll go. I got so frustrated because I'm trying to find a place that Jesus would hang out. So we rented a motorcycle, and we took this motorcycle up and down, if you've been in Spain, up and down the mountains trying to find a secluded beach on the Mediterranean. Found one. Nobody there. We looked up way down there, and it was beautiful, crystal clear water. It was perfect. We had to hoof it to get down there, but we did it. Hooked it all the way down there. Got all the way down. There they are. People laying totally naked on the beach. I said, Ryan, we can't be here either. He goes, Daddy, I'm tired of going all over the place. I said, fine, we're going home. We are going home because none of those places would be a place where Jesus would hang out. Boy, it gets quiet when you talk about stuff like this. I mean, it does. It does, friend. Some of you are going, well, I don't know if I'd have moved so quick. You know, I need to understand the culture there. Maybe I should have just stuck around, you know, and if I was there, Steve, I'd have discussed it with them and asked them why they're naked. I don't think so, friend. It means in habitual fellowship with God. Friend, that's how I want to live. When I think of someone who walked in communion with God, have you ever read about Enoch in Genesis 5, 22 through 24? Enoch walked with God. He was so close to God, God sucked him off the planet. You know what? God looking down at Enoch going, this is so silly, Enoch. Come on, just come on. Because he's always, I can see Enoch going, oh, I love you, 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 I love you. Enoch, how you doing? Fine, I love you, Jesus. Time for dinner. I don't want dinner. I want God. I want God. I want God. Aren't you going to eat in it? No, I want Jesus. I want God. I want God. I want the Father. I want the Father. I want God. I want God. I want God. I love you, God. I love you, God. Thank you for the trees. Thank you for the birds. After a while, God's going, this doesn't make any sense, this separation here. Because he's always talking with me. And he just took him on home. Communion with him, friend. I think of Psalm 1. Blessed is a man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bring forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. These are people that walk with God. Are you paying attention? I think of John, who hung out with Jesus. Two times in the scriptures I found this morning where John laid his head on Jesus' breast. That means he was always close. Who got the revelation? John. Why? Always close. You want a revelation? Hang close to him. People say, well, I want to abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Friend, if you're going to abide under the shadow, you got to be close. You got to be close. See, I got a shadow right here. If you want to abide under my shadow, you better get close, because my shadow's not over there. It ain't back there. It's right here. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Psalm 91:1. I will say unto the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress and my God. In him will I trust. Of course you will. You're abiding under his shadow. He is everything to you. Friend, you've got to be awfully close to be under the shadow of the Lord. I'm going to move on from this one point. No one... What's my first point? Noah was near to God. Richard, stay near to God. I want to tell you what's going to happen. For those of you watching at home, I'm speaking to a man who's given his life to God just over the last few days and has got a lot of decisions to make in the future. A lot of business decisions, a lot of family decisions. And Satan's going to come along and he's going to try to cool you off. He's going to say, Richard, all right. You want some of this God stuff? I'll find you a church where you can have some God stuff and have your old life too. Next thing you know, you'll be lukewarm. Little bit of God, little bit of the world. Jesus said he'll spew you from his mouth. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 13:33, do not be deceived, but bad company corrupts good morals. You want to have good morals? Stay near to God. Hang out with good people. That's why I surround myself with godly people. When I travel with godly people. Wherever I go, I hang out with godly people. Why? I don't want to be corrupted, friend. Now, witnessing is a different story. That's a whole different story. When you're coming out of your world, walking into their world, sharing the gospel. But you don't move into the... You don't... To reach a junkie, you don't start hitting up heroin. To win someone in a bar, you don't go in there and watch a striptease show just so you can relate to them. You stay near to God, friend. Boy, I want to be like you, Noah. Well, he was near. Not only was Noah near to God, here's the second point. Noah was a man obedient to the commands of God. Obedient. N stands for... O stands for? He was obedient. Now, I'm going to show you something, friend, here. Now, Hebrews 11:7 says this. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house. This is Hebrews 11:7. You can look it later. By the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Noah had fear. He feared God, so he built an ark, friend. He was obedient. Now, I'm going to show you a few things. And some of you folks here are struggling with this, with obedience. I'm going to stay a couple minutes on this. Is that okay? I want you to hear me, because some of you think you're obedient, but you're obedient to the point that it fits into your realm. And if it's outside of your realm, then you're disobedient. Then you say, well, that couldn't have been God. Because he would never ask me. That's why I'm afraid of all the prosperity that's going on right now in this nation. People are building houses and they have cars and they have and God wants to move some of them to the jungles of Africa. But because we've taught in America that you keep moving up, no one can turn around and go the other way. That's one of the reasons my wife and I haven't built a house yet. We're struggling with it. We don't own a home here. That's one of the reasons we live in a rent, we live in a parsonage. One of the biggest struggles I have, Pastor, is I want to be able to move on. I can't stand tentacles. I can't stand these roots in this world. I hate them. We have moved over and over and over again. Every time we move, we're free as birds. It's like we can go anywhere we want to in the world because everything we own is in a few boxes. I love that. I love that. That's when Bob knows. He runs our ministry. He knows. I struggled with this thing. Just struggle with it constantly. Do we build a house here for the family? And I've told my family, if we build a house, don't ever forget that halfway through the building of it, Dad could pull up roots and move the whole shebang to another country of the world. Do you understand that, Ryan? Do you understand that, Shelby? Kelsey's too young. She doesn't understand. Jerry understands. She's been all over the globe with me. She knows. I mean, we moved over to Russia. We've moved to Spain. We've moved in Argentina, kept moving around places. Why? It was called obedience. Say obedience. Obedience. Here's a man named Noah. God comes to him in the Word in Genesis 6, 14. I want you to see what he says. Turn there with me. Make thee an ark of gopher wood. You got that? Okay. Room shalt thou make in the ark, and shall pitch it within and without with pitch. And this is a fashion which thou shalt make it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, the breadth of 50 cubits, and the height of it 30 cubits. A window shalt thou make to the ark, and in a cubit shalt thou finish it above. And the door of the ark shalt thou set in the side thereof, with lower, second, and third story shalt thou make it. I'm going to read on in just a minute, friend, but this is one heavy-duty project. I don't know, Bible school student, what God's telling you to do, but I doubt it if it's anything close to this one. This boat, and theologians argue on this, but I'm just going to give you a tiny boat here. A cubit, most theologians believe, was about 18 inches. Thank you, Mike. But others believe it's a lot longer. There's some people that believe the ark was 3 miles long. You know, I'm going, I don't think so. But whatever you want to believe. But this, but this boat was, if you watch the Super Bowl, longer than the stadium, longer than a football field. 100 feet past the football field was this boat. That's a big project. Say big project. Noah got the building plans from God. And he said, I want you to build this thing. Noah started looking around at the trees that were available for this mammoth project. The materials. There were no Handy Dans and Home Depots and all them kind of Wicks lumber back in those days, friend. He had to do this all on his own. Big project. But you know what Noah is? He's... He is first the boat. Then verse 17. I'm going to move quickly through this, so pay attention. God says this, oh, Noah, I'm going to bring a flood. A lot of water. I'm going to kill everything. Everything that breathes, I'm going to kill it. Everything under heaven, I'm going to kill it. That's verse 17 in paraphrased. But Noah, verse 18, but with thee will I establish my covenant, and thou shalt come into the ark, thou and thy sons and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. Oh, Noah, but also one of every living thing of all flesh, two of every sort shalt thou bring into the ark to keep them alive with thee. They shall be male and female. Now remember, God only said to put one window. Now here he's telling to bring all these mooses and all these elephantes and all these giraffes and all these lions and tigers and bears. They're listening. I know what movie you've been watching. Y'all remember when The Wizard of Oz was on every single year? Remember that? It was like a big thing. That's how we know, oh my. It was beat into us for years and years. But Noah was commanded to bring all these animals in, friend. This was a major task. And take thou unto thee of all the food that is eaten, verse 21, and thou shalt gather it to thee, and it shall be for food for thee and for them. Thus did Noah, according to all that God commanded him, so did he. I love this, friend. A Noah wannabe. Now, this is a heavy part right here. How many have owned animals? A doggy, a kitty, a hamster, fishies. I've owned animals. They come, they go. Just feed them too much, feed them little, you know. Put them on fast, you know. Shadow, you're going to fast for a week for your owner. Getting too plump. But Noah, I want you to open those doors right there. Noah had to get the food for all these animals. Now, Mike, before you do this, guys, before you do it, Mike, you're a theologian. Matter of fact, you're a Noahologist, aren't you? An archologist. An ark. Noah's ark. Archologist. Okay? And I know you've got a degree in Noahology, but a Noah tech. Okay. But Mike, the Bible is not very specific, but I know you can read into the original. How many animals were on that boat? Whatever you can give us from the depth of your wisdom. The clean and the unclean. Male and female.
In Hebrew, we would say harbe.
Harbe. How many will accept harbe? I don't accept it. What does it mean, Mike?
A lot.
A lot. Thank you, Mike. A lot of animals, friend. I want everyone to look this way. I want you to begin to understand the impact of his obedience. Noah. Now, I have shared some things in this revival. We've studied species, and I've shared that there's over 100,000 species of flies. 100,000 species, not 100,000 flies. You've had that many in your house. 100,000 species. That means God has made over 100,000 different kinds of flies, and that's what man has discovered so far. So you've got to imagine the mammoth task that Noah had. Now, God was going to help him with the animals, but he had to feed these guys. So Noah had to go out, and he had to get food for the horses. He had to get food for the animals. Come on, bring that first thing in there. He went out and said, he told his sons, we need some hay. So they bring in some hay. Brings the hay all the way down. I want you to put the hay up here on the ark, buddy. I want you to lay it right up here. Friend, let me tell you about hay. I've owned horses. This is fresh baled hay. Thank you very much. This is a fresh bale of hay. Now, custodians, forgive me ahead of time. This is hay. As a matter of fact, turn this thing around forward, okay? Somebody help me with this. Bill, my man, you've owned horses, have you, buddy? Do they eat horse? Hay and horses go together, don't they? Hey, friend, that is one bale of hay. He did not have one donkey. And they were on that boat, according to our archaeologist. Would you stand? Mike, I know you've studied archaeology, boatology, floodology. How long were they on the boat? This is a serious answer because this, I want you to feel the obedience of Noah.
Bear in mind that there were limited bathroom facilities for all the animals.
Thank you for that. For that insight. Mike, let me ask you something about that one window. There were no trains on the boat. Thank you, Mike.
But in all seriousness,
that's what we need.
The flood began on the
first day of Noah's 600th year.
Okay.
The boat settled on Mount Ararat on the 17th day of the 7th month.
Okay.
To that point, at least 197 days, and they still couldn't get out yet for a few more weeks.
Ah. So we're in this boat with all these animals for over a half a year. I want you to feel the obedience of Noah, friend. Some of you are going through trials right now. You ain't gone through no trial. Let me just give you an up-to-date example of what Noah felt, okay? We have a cat. Say cat. We have a van. Say van. We have a rule in our van. This is we traded our van in. We got a newer van just recently because we have three kids, and you know what they can do to a van. And so before it's totally demolished, we try to get some money out of it. And so we traded it in, and we have a rule. You cannot chew gum. You cannot drink Coke. You cannot eat a candy bar. You cannot eat a quarter pounder. No French fry is allowed in the van. That's the rule in our van. No drive-throughs. You go in. If you got time, you go in. If you don't have time, you don't eat in the van. Why? We don't want to trash this thing, okay? The last van had about 200 pounds of Coke dried into the carpet. So we decided not to. How many know what I'm talking about, okay? So we got this van. The other day, I went to get in it, and I opened it up, and I looked in, and there was that cat. And the cat went, meow, just like that. And then I went, our male cat, who had not been to the vet yet, had been locked in the van for at least 24 hours, if not 48 hours. Locked in. We're still working on it, friend. That was like 3 weeks ago. We got an ozone machine inside that thing going full. Friend, we're doing everything. You've been there. You know, you work with us, Heidi. This is a trip, man. One little old van. I don't know, what is that? Like 6 cubits long or something? I don't know how long it is. A little old van. I can't imagine what Noah was going through. How many bales of hay the man had to put in his ark to keep the animals alive for 6 months. Well, how about, not all the animals eat hay. You know, you'll have some giraffe will come up and go, I'm not eating that, Noah. You'll have some dog that'll come up and go, I don't eat hay. What do you think, I am a horse? And so Noah has to go out and get all the other stuff, and I want you to bring all three of them in. Noah has to pile on his wheelbarrow and start bringing in all this different kind of feed. And I imagine he went out and he got corn. I imagine he went out and he got oats. I imagine he went out and got some fresh leaves for the giraffes. Pile them all right here, friend. This is just the beginning, okay? No, I'm not going to bring a whole... It's right here. Wait a minute. What is this? Chicken feed. Got to feed the chickens. What's this? Crimped oats. Got to feed the horses. What you got there? Oh, hold that up for everybody to see. Look at their happy dog food. Why? You want the dogs happy. What happened? There you go. If you can't see it, it's on the widescreen. That's right, critics. Eat your heart out. The Brownsville Revival. Noah had to load up that ark, friend, with food for every one of those animals. This was a major undertaking. Say major undertaking.
Major undertaking.
He built the ark. He loaded up the animals. He loaded up their food, and the Bible says in Genesis 7:5, and Noah did according unto all, say all that the Lord commanded him. Friend, Noah was obedient. This was ridiculous. Could you imagine what his neighbors were saying to him? Oh, got enough? No, as a matter of fact, we need 800 more bales. Oh, you're going to be floating around for a while? Taking a long trip, Noah? Imagine the riddle, because some of you are going through a little ridicule. A little ridicule because of obedience to God. You're out evangelizing and someone doesn't want to talk to you. They cuss you out and you just squirm away and you hang your head down and you whimper off. It took him 100 years to build a boat. It took a lifetime to get everything in it. Now, before I move off of this, because I want to stay on it, God's speaking to some of you about getting the sin out of your life. He's looking for some Noahs. Why don't you tonight be obedient? Here's a man that was light years ahead of you. The Bible doesn't talk about all the sin Noah was in. The Bible talks about his obedience. Working for God, going after God, doing what God told him to do. There's a song that was written back in the early 80s by one of my favorite artists. Many of you know him, Keith Green. And I want you to hear this. I want you to hear this. We lived right by his property. Matter of fact, he's buried right next to Leonard Ravenhill. He's buried, and he's got both of his children buried in his arms. And it says on the tombstone, gone to be with Jesus. Those of you that are unfamiliar, he died in a plane crash with his kids. And I wept and wept and wept when he died because I love Keith. As a matter of fact, we had him booked for a concert just 2 months after that. And I just cried, not because of the concert, because I love the man. He was ahead of his time. And I want everyone, don't close your eyes. I want you to leave your eyes open, but I want you to prayerfully listen to this song. To obey is better than sacrifice. God is looking for obedience. What we do is we'll go to church, we'll pay our tithes, we'll give an offering, and God's telling us to go ourselves. We'll put a Bible school student through school, and God's telling us to go through the school. We'll send a missionary to the field and God's telling us to go down and live there for 6 months. We got neighbors that are away from God and God's telling us, would you just go over there and talk to them about God? I talk to them about my love and you struggle and you whimper. But you know what you do? You come on Sunday and you'll worship God. And this is what God's saying to you. Turn it up.
I don't need your money, I want your life. And I hear you say that I'm coming back soon, but you act like I'm never returning. Well, you speak of grace and my love so sweet. How you thrive on milk but reject my meat. And I can't help weeping at how it will be if you keep on ignoring my word. Well, you pray to prosper and succeed, but your flesh is something I just can't feed.
Can you give us a monitor on that? Hear it, friend.
To obey is better than sacrifice. I want more than Sundays and Wednesday nights.
I want hearts of fire, not your prayers of ice. And I'm coming quickly to give back to you according to what you have done, according to what you have done, according to what you have done.
Well said. Friend, I want you to feel the impact of what Noah went through. I want to be like him. I want God to be able to lay on me the biggest burden that he's ever had. I want it to be heavier than Noah's. Doesn't matter. I want to be a yes man. I want to be a yes man. If he wants to strip me of all my earthly possessions, I want to be a yes man. Sure, God. Whatever you want me to do. If he says, Steve, I want you to stay on the road the rest of your life. I don't want you to have one place to call your home. I want to be a yes man. I want to go to my children and say, kids, we're going to live on the road the rest of our lives. We will never have a home of our own. And I want my kids to go, it's fine, Dad. If that's what God's told you, that's what we're going to do. Why? I want to be obedient. I want to be obedient in everything. Noah was obedient, and we can learn a lesson from this man of God. He's in the Word. His story's in the Word for us to learn to grow. Number three, Noah was a man who made himself available to God. Say available. And God said unto Noah, the end of all flesh is come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. And so he said, make an ark. You won't find in the scripture where Noah said, not me. He was available right then. There's some folks within the sound of my voice, I want you to hear me at home. There's some folks, you make yourself available, but later on. You're saying, God, I will do what you want me to do, but first, I need to get married. But first, I need to have children. But first, I need to do this. But first, I need to make this amount of money, and then I will be available. Friend, I want you to listen to me and listen to me clear. God will pass you by. He's looking for some Noahs. Noah got right to it. Yes, sir. When, sir? Now, boy. Yes, sir. How big? Big. Yes, sir. Are you going to help me? A little bit, but most of it's on your shoulders. Yes, sir. Is it gonna smell? Yes, sir. What are we supposed to do about all that? Live there. Suffer through it. Yes, sir. Don't you tell me he didn't give some thought to this stuff, friend. I mean, they were going, it does not say, and build this ark and put this window, put a waste disposal every 5 feet. Doesn't say that. He was available. How many times has God asked you to do something, but you were not available? What has he asked you to do? How many times has he asked you to do one thing, and you've turned him down a dozen times? Number four, and I'm closing. This is a Noah wannabe. Noah was a man who lived holy unto the Lord. In near. O, obedient. A, available. H, holy. I love this, friend. Genesis 7:1 says this, Lord said to Noah, enter the ark, you and all your household, for you alone I have seen to be righteous before me in this time. I want to tell you the statement that I made a few minutes ago bothered some people here. I said this. I said, I'm wondering if God's just going to sort of wrap this thing up. He's got a holy bride, Mike. Pastor, he's got a holy bride. Right now, he has got a bride that is on fire after him. The rapture took place right now, there would be millions sucked off the earth that would make up his glorious bride at the wedding supper of the Lamb. Millions and millions. There's over half a billion Pentecostal people. And I'm not saying all those folks are going, but the church is huge. And one of the reasons I love foreign work is because when you go in some of these third world countries, you will see what the love of Jesus is. These people are so in love with Jesus. Everything's Jesus. Everything. Money doesn't own them. Cars don't own them. Jesus owns them. They'll do anything for God. But he's holy. And right here, the Bible says, you alone, Noah, you alone, you read it for yourself in Genesis 7:1. For you alone I have seen to be righteous before me in this time. And then you read the words of Jesus. It's recorded more than once, but in Matthew 24:37, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Maybe there's just going to be a few righteous people hanging out. You alone, Noah. Friend, I'm telling you right now, I'm ready for him to come back right now. I'm living holy, living clean. Don't have one thing on my conscience that bothers me. One thing, nothing pricks me. Everyone within the sound of my voice needs to be living like that tonight. Because I'm wondering, since Jesus says, as it was in the days of Noah, I'm wondering if he's going down. Well, Father, it's those alone right there. Just those. Just those people right there. Out of billions and billions and billions. That's what I got right there, Father. Those are sincere worshipers. I know them. They know me. Now, Father, there are millions that are working for me, but they don't know me. But I know this group right here. I know them. They're obedient. They're available. They're near to me, and they're holy. Everyone stand. Charity, come join me. You know, the humor in this story is so far outweighed by the seriousness of it. You know what happened? After all this cargo was on board, God sealed the door and the floods came. I preached a message here at the Brownsville Revival entitled, and you need to get the message if they still have it available here. It's called The Sermon from the Last Summit. And it was the sermon that the last person on earth would have preached at the very top of the last mountain, on top of the tree of the last mountain, hanging on, watching the ark float off in the distance. Corpses are floating everywhere all around him. Everyone's dead. It's the last person alive. The sermon from the last summit. The waters covered the earth, the Bible said. There had to be times with a last peak, and people were scrambling to the highest mountain as the waters rose. Here's a man on the top of the tree of the last mountain, and the water's coming up the bark, coming up the trunk. What do you think he would say? He would say things like, things are not as they seem. I was marrying my daughter. She was having a wedding, a big celebration. Just a short while ago, my daughter died in the deluge. Her fiance died in the deluge. My wife died in the deluge. Things are not as they seem. Then he'd say something like this. Listen to the preacher. Who is it, Mike? Is it Peter that said Noah was a preacher of righteousness? Preacher of righteousness. He would say, listen to the preacher. And then he'd say this. Get on the ark. Get in. Get in. Then the waters would cover his throat, cover his mouth, cover his nose, and he would sink into eternity. But that would be the last words of the last man on earth as God destroyed it all. Right now, I don't want any chairs moved. This is what we're going to do. Charity's going to sing Mercy Seat. Everyone in this room that needs to get right with God, maybe you're backslidden. God got a hold of you at one time in your life, but you backslid. You're doing things that Jesus would never do. Friend, look this way. Everybody in at home, look this way. Tonight, would you be obedient? And if the Holy Spirit is drawing you down to this altar, come down to this altar and get on your face and come clean. Noah was holy. Be like him. Holy. The Bible says Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. If there's anything you want in 1999, it's the creator of the universe kissing your soul. If you're here tonight and you're away from God, you're going to come quickly. If you're in this place and you've never known Jesus as Savior, you're going to come down here and meet the Lord, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Jesus Christ was crucified. We sang about him all night. He was crucified for you 2,000 years ago. The only way into the ark is through the blood of Jesus Christ. The only way to heaven is through the blood of Jesus. He was beaten and whipped for you. He took the worst punishment to cover the worst sin that any man could commit. And you can be redeemed tonight, friend, by asking him to forgive you. It's a mystery how it works, but night after night, we've had 3.5 million people come through this church. Hundreds of thousands have wept at these altars. The number on that sign is so much lower than the actual amount of people that have been down here crying their eyes out, getting right with God. Join them tonight when this altar call is given. And those of you that are religious, you're religious. You know all about him, but you don't know him. When this altar call is given, when charity begins to sing, get down here. Get down here. You're religious, but you're not near to God. You're religious, but you're not available to God. You're religious, but you're not obedient to God. You're religious, but you're not holy. You don't even know him, but you sing in the choir. You may play the organ. You may have gone on mission trips. You may be a deacon, but you don't know God. You may be sanctimonious in reading your Bible and just faithful to say some prayers every morning, but you don't know Jesus. Many will say on that day, the Bible doesn't say a few, the Bible says many will say, in your name we cast out devils, in your name we prophesied, and he will say, depart from me, I never knew you. That means you did it all outside of my lordship. You're rebellious and you didn't make it in. That's a warning to everyone in ministry. It's a warning to everyone within the sound of my voice, everyone at home. Tonight you can secure your relationship with Jesus Christ. When this altar call is given, when charity begins to sing Mercy Seat, don't let anything hold you back. And for the Lord's sake, don't let pride get in your way tonight. I could have entitled this whole message, Noah, the man with no pride. No man could have done this, friend, unless he was selfless. It was insane. He was the mockery of the world. But he kept on building. Don't let the devil talk you out of this altar call because of pride. I can't go down there. What will people think? People aren't thinking about you, friend. They're thinking about their own selves. You need to think about your own soul. The only place you're going to get right is down at these altars, friend, not in your pew, not up there in the balcony. You're going to come down here. At home, you're going to kneel right there at the couch, right there in front of that TV set. That's the only way to get right. Why? The Bible says pride, that God resists the proud. So if you're proudful, he's turned from you. But he gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Charity's going to sing Mercy Seat. If you need forgiveness, if you need to fall into obedience to God, if you need to get right with God tonight, do not hesitate, friend. Don't turn to the left or turn to the right. You need to come straight down here. If you need forgiveness, come on right now. Hurry, 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 hurry. Come on right now. Hurry, 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 hurry.
Everything is unknown.
Come on, in the balcony, let's go.
I face the power of sin on my own.
Come on, come on. God bless you, sis. God bless you, son. God bless you, son.
Where I could find a way to heal my wounded soul.
Come on, come on,
come on.
Come on.
Come on. Come
on. Come on.
Come on.
Come on. Come on.
Hurry.
Hurry. If you need forgiveness, bring them around here, ushers. Come on. Come on.
Come on.
All the way over, kids. All the way over. Come on.
Come on. Come on.
Come on. Come on.
It will provide the
come on.
Healing. I'm running
come on.
To the mercy
come on.
Seat.
Come on.
I'm running
come on.
To the mercy seat.
How about it, friend? Noah was a man of righteousness. He was a man of obedience. He was available to God, and he was near to the Lord. You need to be like Noah. You need to be a man that God can call on. You need to be a man and a woman that God can say, I want you to do a job. I want you to do a task. And you say, yes, Lord, here am I. I'll do it. If you don't know the Lord, you need to get on your knees and ask him to wash you and cleanse you. If you know the Lord, you need to get in line with him and say, Jesus, whatever you want me to do, I'll do. Do that right now. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. It's good, Charity. We're not going to go through the whole song tonight, friend. I'm going to close this altar call right now. Everyone turn to the person next to them and ask them this question. You're going to ask them if they need Jesus Christ. At the altar, stay right where you're at. You ask the person next to you if they need Jesus Christ to forgive them. When someone asks you that question, don't lie to them. If you need forgiveness tonight, you know you're out of obedience to God. You know you're rebelling. You be honest with them. And if they say yes, both of you come down together. Come on, right now. Everyone turn to the person next to them and ask them if they need forgiveness. And then both of you come down together. God bless you, sir. Come on. Come on. We got a team? Come on. Come on. Don't move any chairs, ushers. Don't move the chairs. Stop singing. Everyone at the altar, let's bow. Jesus, pray with me right now. Jesus, everyone at the altar, pray with me right now. Jesus, I come to you, obeying you. You've spoken to me. I ask you tonight to forgive me. I have sinned. I have hurt you. I have hurt others. I've hurt myself. Forgive me, Jesus. Wash me, Jesus. Cleanse me, Jesus. Make me new. I ask you tonight to be my Savior. be my Lord and my very best friend. From this moment on, I am yours and you are mine. Jesus, come live your life through me. And tonight, I want to be like Noah. I want everyone to pray this in this whole place. Tonight, I want to be like Noah. I want to be near. I want to be obedient. I want to be available. And I want to be holy. I want to be like Noah. I want you, you Heavenly Father, to find favor when you look at me. Jesus, I give myself to you. In your precious name.
In your precious name.
Amen. Amen. Glory. Everyone at the altar. Everyone at the altar.